Next Sunday is Easter Sunday, so we won't be continuing with our series on Acts. We will have a resurrection message. Amen? Next Sunday morning. So join us then, but go ahead and get one of these for now, and we will do, we'll cover about half of it or so today, and then after Easter, we'll send you an announcement again, but maybe the week after Easter or after that, we'll continue with this. So no need to bring it next week, but following week when you come back, like it or not, you're going to see my face for a few weeks. Where are you going, Pastor Renee?
Going to Canada on Tuesday
this week.
My mother is turning 90 years old.
Yeah.
And we are going to surprise with a visit and a surprise party. So I missed two Sundays.
Yeah.
After Easter.
There you go. So please don't send a face. Does your mom read Facebook?
No.
Okay. In other words, no Facebook messages. Bye, Pastor Renee. Hope you have a good time in Canada with your mother as well. So, anyhow, but he'll be back. And do pray for him as he goes. He'll be speaking in many churches. I tell you, folks, when we go back to the U.S. and to Canada, believe me, we don't stay in our pajamas and put our feet up and swing back and forth in a hammock. And drink iced tea most of the time. There are a few days of break, but in fact, way more than half, perhaps two-thirds of our time back, and we're back in our home countries, will be work-related as well. So keep Pastor Renee in prayer as he goes, that there will be some time of refreshing as well as he is there. And here we continue with the things that we're doing here. Hey, come this Friday night. It's Good Friday. Join us. It will be as it always is, it's a simple service. It's not a long service. It's a lot more informal. We'll share communion together. We'll have a time of worship. And then at the end of that, we'll have a potluck on the fourth floor. Some of you come from church backgrounds and church traditions where perhaps the idea of having a potluck on Good Friday is kind of terrible, right? It's like, you're having a meal on Good Friday? Why aren't you fasting on Friday to commemorate the sacrifice of our Savior Jesus Christ? But what we have seen, in our understanding and with our hearts, so just so that you understand, we don't dishonor the Lord. It's not our intention to dishonor the Lord Jesus Christ and His sacrifice in any way by having a potluck and a fellowship time together on Friday evening. But just as the early church gathered together frequently in fellowship and in love feasts, we gather together this Friday evening because Jesus has paid the price and He has risen from the dead for you and for me. And so we gather together. We invite you to join us. It'll be simple. And you may say, well, I can't prepare food or whatever, so maybe I shouldn't come. If you can't prepare food, come anyhow. You can pick up some fruit. If your finances are really tight and you say, well, I can't really even do that, you just come and we'll eat what we have and we'll share and we'll fellowship together in the Lord. We really mean that. And those of us that have more time and perhaps have more resources, we can prepare a little bit more. Just keep it simple and we'll gather together as people who have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb as we remember our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. So do join us, if you will, this Friday evening. 4:30, short service, fellowship time together, and then a meal together in fellowship. So this morning, but we continue this morning with our study in the book of Acts, that great, exciting book, all of these things happening, all these things going on. And if you'll remember two weeks ago now, we ended on an extremely dramatic note. We ended with the death of by judgment of God, the death of Ananias and the death of his wife Sapphira 3 hours later. So we're going to pick up from there, but we're not going to stay there this morning. We're going to move on. And so as you're looking at your notes, you can look at the front part if you want to. This will give you some information, but mostly you'll want to turn to the second page. And the second page, there's some things. We'll get about this far today, and there's some things here. I'm not trying to test you, but I like to give you notes with some blanks so that you perhaps will listen a little more intently than you might otherwise listen. So that's why I do it. As always, I'll put it up here. You want to see my answers afterwards, but the answers are really easy this time. You can easily get them. It'll just help you kind of pay attention as we go along. And so Ananias and Sapphira are killed, are judged by God. And my question as we get into our study this morning, let's look at Acts 5, verse 5 and verse 11. I've given you a blank space in your notes. What is the immediate response to God's judgment on Ananias and Sapphira's deliberate sin? Now, there are other results after that, but the immediate result is what? These two verses tell us. What are the results? Fear. Okay. Fear are the two results. Now, let me ask you. So, look at that. Great fear seized all who heard what had happened. Wow. You know, sometimes we think gossip travels fast, right? How fast do you think this one traveled? Somebody struck down in church because of sinning and hypocrisy. And then verse 11, after Sapphira is judged and dies as well, great fear, both times, great fear, seized the whole church, and then actually outside the church, right? This is what this tells us. So this news gets outside the church and all who heard about these events. So this is going to help us understand what comes next. So here is this great fear falls on everybody. And I want us to think of something real in a real practical sense related to us this morning as we look at this. Because if this is just a history lesson, forget it. Go to the museum instead. But the history of God and God's people has something to tell to our lives as well. And so we see this initial response, immediate response of great fear. Now, I want to ask you something. Have you ever been afraid of something? Have you ever had fear that gripped your heart about something? Probably most of us have. And most of the time when fear grips our hearts, it's not a good thing, is it? When fear grips our hearts, usually it disturbs us. It weakens us, doesn't it? You know, something happens and it makes us, in the Bible sometimes, their hearts fail them for fear, and it weakens us. But I want us to see something this morning, because this is not what happens as we look at this passage and then move on into the church, because you remember the title that we just looked at, A Pure and Powerful Church. So, and we see it from this point onward especially. Great fear seizes everyone. This is not a fear that a worldly fear, but this is a godly fear. This is the right type of fear. And so what I want to ask you this morning as we look at this is this. Is this the type of fear that you and I have? Well, I'm going to go ahead and tell you right now, it is the type of fear that we should have. And some of us may be surprised because we think, well, we're not supposed to be afraid. The Bible says perfect love casts out all fear. And then in other places, in Philippians, and the peace of God will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. And don't be anxious about anything. Instead, pray about everything. And so how does this fear fit in the right way? How is this fear a good fear in our lives as children of God this morning? And this story, rather than being, a history of something that happened a long time ago, gives us some really good understanding of what things should be like in our own lives as well. This is not a popular subject. It's not a popular topic. And in a lot of places, you probably won't hear any messages about fear. Instead, I want to hear about blessing. I want to hear about victory. I want to hear about healing and deliverance. We all like that, don't we? But this is part of God's word. And we know something right now. We know that when God did that, because he's God, he knew that great fear would be the immediate result. He knew that. And so what purpose, why did God do that? And what can the right type of fear do in our hearts and in our lives? So I want us to think about that as we go into this morning and where we fit as well. What we see is this, as we look at this. God does this. The church has seen miracles of blessing. The church has seen miracles of healing. The church has seen miracles of deliverance and provision, and now the church sees a miracle of judgment, okay? It's a miracle of judgment. Man didn't do this. Peter didn't have the power to do that. That's in your notes. So if you're taking the notes, it says, in fact, this is a miracle of judgment. It's something miraculous that happens. If you does this ever happen in the Old Testament as well? Sure it does. Sure it does. In the Old Testament, at some point when the children of Israel were going through the wilderness, there was a rebellion against Moses and against Aaron and the priests, and it was so bad. It was near the beginning as the tabernacle was set up. It was so bad in God's eyes that he called out those that had rebelled against Moses and against Aaron, along with their families, and he called them out. And do you know what the miraculous judgment was? The ground opened up. And Moses said, if the ground opens up and swallows them whole, you will know that this is God. Guess what happened? That's what happened. That's what happened. And sometimes we see God's judgment, and it is a miraculous, it really is a miraculous judgment. We're going to talk about this morning as well, because this isn't very popular with Christians either. I don't want to hear about judgment. I want to hear about grace. I want to hear about blessings and things like that. But we see this in the early church. We're going to see why it's important. There are some times when there is the judgment of God on our lives. And do you know what? May I say this to you this morning? And this is not a full mess. This is not really a message on judgment, but this is part of the story. I do believe that there are times when, as Christians, because of things in our lives, there is God's judgment on our lives. He still loves us. He loves us fully. There's nothing you can do that will lessen God's love for you. Did you know that? You can be walking in sin and problems and this and that, and God will still love you so much. His love for you remains the same. But when, as God's children and as God's people, there will be times when you and I have things in our life that the Holy Spirit is trying to deal with, wants to work on, and we resist, and we don't let him, there may be God's judgment in our lives. Now, we may not fall over dead, as Ananias and Sapphira did, but there will be the judgment of God. Why? Why? Because God loves us, and because God loves his church. That is why there is judgment. It's not anger. I'm mad at you. You've done wrong. That is never how God treats his children. If you are his child this morning, God doesn't deal with you in that way. But God, who is holy, will always work to protect the purity and the holiness of his church so that his church is like he is. Jesus gave himself in the New Testament. It says he gave himself, he offered himself up as a sacrifice, that he shed his blood, that he might present a church. That's you and me, brothers and sisters. He might present a church that is holy, spotless, without wrinkle, and without blemish. That is the ongoing work of the blood of Jesus Christ applied by the Holy Spirit in our lives. Does that make sense to us this morning? And that's what God will do. So there are times when, in love, he brings judgment because he wants purity in his church. He wants his church to be like himself. So God, in this case, protects the purity and the unity of his church through this judgment. And what we see is that the fear of the Lord that comes does not weaken. So I want you to see that this morning. It's a fear when it is the right type of fear of the Lord. Guess what will happen in your life when you and I have the fear of the Lord? You will not be weaker. You will be stronger. You say, come on, Pastor Jennifer, are you sure? I'm pretty sure. May I give you two examples very briefly? Let's look at Acts 9:31. This is years later. And we see this. So here's the church as it's going on. And it says, it became stronger as the believers lived how? What does it say? How? Lived in the fear of the Lord. It became stronger? Yes, it became stronger because the fear of the Lord purifies. The fear of the Lord purifies the believer. And when you and I are walking in holiness and purity, we are strong in the Lord. And that is why the title of this was A Pure and Powerful Church. And we'll look at that in just a minute. Purity gives a place for the power of God in our lives. Let me tell you something this morning, brothers and sisters. If you and I are living with sin and compromise in our lives, we will not have victory in our lives. We will not have the power of the Lord manifest in our lives. It will not happen. God doesn't do it that way. God works with a pure church, and he works to have a pure church and pure believers. And we'll look at this a little bit more. And with the encouragement of the Holy Spirit, it also grew in numbers. Sometimes, we'll talk about this a little bit more, sometimes we're afraid, churches are afraid, oh, if we preach holiness and purity, people will run away from the church. No. This brings people into God's church. Let's look at another passage, Acts 19, 17 through 19. And this one is really dramatic. In this one, I didn't include it for the sake of time, but you go back and read it on your own if you're taking notes. In this one, there were seven Jewish exorcists. They were all brothers. And they had gone around, and they didn't know Jesus. But they walked around, they traveled from place to place, and they tried to deliver people from demonic possession and demonic influence by saying, in the name of Paul, who that way, because they didn't have a direct relationship with God. They said, oh, in the name of Paul, the one who this, that, and the other, we command you to come out. And you know what happened one time? So here it is. They were pretending to be living up here, but their lives were really what? Right down here. Just like Ananias and Sapphira, right? We gave it all, but they didn't, did they? They didn't give it all. Their lives were down here. So that's really a lesson for us. And they pretended, oh, you come out, you're this and that. They pretended to be, their front was, we're powerful servants of God. And then they met a demon-possessed man who said, I know Paul and I know Jesus. Who are you? The demon-possessed man, in the power and in demonic power, beat up all seven of them, tore off their clothes. Now you think about a scandal, tore off their clothes, they were bleeding, and they went running out of the house into the street. And what does it say? A solemn fear. So it spread quickly. You bet it would spread quickly. If it happened in Hong Kong, it spread quickly too, wouldn't it? And what does it say? A solemn fear descended on the city, and the name of the Lord Jesus was greatly honored. Brothers and sisters, when there is purity and the fear of the Lord, the name of the Lord Jesus is honored. It brings honor to his name. And many who became believers confessed their sinful practices. So they came into the family of God, and it wasn't a halfway Christianity. Oh, one of the worst things that can happen to people as they sort of come into the family of God is to kind of live halfway in between how they used to live and how they should be living. There is no joy in that. Some of us have tried to live that way before, haven't we? There's no joy there. There's very little victory. Get this way or get that way. But it says they confessed their sinful practices. So they came into the family of God, and they completely came into the family of God. And so we see this as God works to protect the purity of his church. And what we see is that as he does that, things happen in the church because there's a fear of the Lord. So here's an application for us this morning as we look at this. And here's my question to you this morning. My question is this. This morning, are you as a Christian living in the fear of the Lord? Are you really living in the fear of the Lord? And I do not mean, oh, God's going to get me. Because you know what? I sometimes meet Christians like that. Have you ever lived like that? You're so scared if you do one thing wrong, boom, God's going to hit you. Boom, he's going to get you. That is not God. That's not God. He is not like that. He's not like that. To live in the fear of the Lord and to walk in the fear of the Lord means that I'm living as God calls me to live. And if I fall or if I stumble, I take care of it. And I take care of it right away. And I take care of it in the right way. In the right way. So my question is, how do you regard your brothers and sisters in Lighthouse? How do you regard the family of God this morning? In your thoughts and in your words, How do you speak of and think of your brothers and sisters this morning? How do you speak of and think of the pastors this morning? How do you speak of and think of in your attitude and truly, and you know what I mean, you know what I mean, are we walking in the fear of the Lord this morning? And we know whether we are or whether we aren't. And if we're not, we are in a dangerous place. Why? Because God cares about His church and God works to protect His church. And I'm not trying to scare you this morning, because if I'm trying to scare you, that's the wrong type of fear. But the Holy Spirit can bring the right type of fear into our hearts and lives so that as Christians, we are walking in purity. We're walking in the right way. If I have the fear of the Lord, I am not going to let my heart be full of unforgiveness towards you. Even though, you know, sometimes honestly, we get more hurt by people, by brothers and sisters inside the church than outside of the church, don't we? Because we think, well, they're my brothers and they're my sisters. And we get more hurt by that than we do by those who are outside of the church. And if we're really honest, sometimes we hold more unforgiveness towards Christians than we do towards others, don't we? But when the fear of the Lord is working in our lives, we're not going to let that stay in our hearts. And so there's a purity in our lives. The fear of the Lord purifies us. Now, for some of you who are especially guilt-ridden this morning, and I know some of you, that does not mean that you have to be, that does not mean perfection. You can't make any mistakes, you're perfect. Purity means that if there's sin, you take care of it right away, number one, and number two, you take care of it biblically, okay? So to me, I think that's what it means here. So number one, you take care of it promptly. Don't let it, because you know when we let things that are not right, when we let them stay in our lives, it's a lot harder to get rid of them, isn't it, as it goes on. So number one, you take care of it promptly. Number two, you take care of it biblically. You don't walk around with a black cloud over your head. I'm so bad. I'm such a bad Christian. I failed. Even though you said, God, please forgive me, you're still walking around with condemnation. That is not biblical. That's not biblical. 1 John 1:9, we confess our sins. He is faithful and just to forgive. It doesn't say when you've been sorry long enough, when you have felt badly long enough, then He will forgive you step by step, little by little. That's not what the Word of God says. That's what we feel. Sometimes we think, if I do it that way, then God will really know I'm sorry. That's not in the Bible, brothers and sisters. But there's a purity, so when there's something wrong in our lives, promptly, biblically, and then we keep on walking with the Lord, right? Yes. Does that make sense to us? Amen. If you have any questions after the church, after church, come talk with me. I'll answer those. But that gives us, I think, a good understanding. And so God protects the unity and the purity of His church so that it remains holy then and now as well. Now, what is the longer term? What's the longer term result of the judgment of the Lord and people walking in purity? Well, here's one of them. Then we're going to look at another one. Let's look at Acts 5:12-14, at part of it. Pastor Renee and I have both been to church growth seminars before. You know, that's a big thing in America and in Canada. Go to a church growth seminar. How do you grow your church? How do you make your church bigger? Well, here's one of the results of God's purifying work. The apostles were performing signs and wonders. All the believers were regularly meeting at the temple in the area known as Solomon's Colonnade, but no one else dared to join them, even though all the people had high regard for them. Now, verse 14, which looks like a contradiction, yet more and more people believed and were brought to the Lord, crowds of both men and women. Now, I want you to see something this morning. In verse 13, what does it say? No one dared to join them. What that says to me is there are people say, oh, I'm going to join them because look, it's these Christians. It's Peter and John. All of these things are happening. And there were those who looked at what was going on and were attracted by the excitement and all of this and that. And so there would have been not a full committed I'm going to join them because this is exciting. Instead, we look at verse 14. How does the church go? God draws people. And what does it say? They were brought to the Lord. Who brings a person to the Lord in the truest sense? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. Now, you may bring someone to church. You may pray with someone. But do you know who brings a person to the Lord? The Holy Spirit. It is His job. It's His work. And so what we see here, amazing. Whoever would have thought that a tool of church growth would be judgment and death? I don't know if that'd work in an American church, Pastor Renee, or a Canadian church. I told the story in the first service. You would never believe this of my dad, who was the pastor here years ago in America. They decided to have a competition to grow the Sunday school at New Brockton First Assembly in South Alabama. And Julie, whose father is also a pastor, would understand things like this. And there was a competition among the Sunday school kids. Somebody donated something. There's a competition. Whoever brings the most kids to Sunday school gets a prize. Right, Julie? Did your yeah, that's right. She's nodding her head. Guess what the prize was? A pony. A real pony, living, breathing, eating. Now, in the Philippines, if the pony were a prize, you'd get hundreds of kids to Sunday school, right? Well, let me tell you how effective it wasn't in South Alabama. The kid who won the pony brought two people. And they won the pony. It wasn't very successful as a tool for church growth or for Sunday school growth. Sister Betty was a Sunday school teacher at that time in America, way back when. I was in the Sunday school at that time. Not very effective as a tool for church growth. But may I say something to you this morning? Look at God's judgment and purifying work and the power that came as a tool for church growth. Do you see the difference? When it is God's plan, it works. When it is God's impetus, when God gives the impetus, it works. It works. You and I try all sorts of things to make things happen in God's church, don't we? And to make things happen in our life. Oh, we try this and we try that. But when it comes from God, it will be effective. When it is God's plan, done God's way, with God's power, it works. And we see that one of the results then of the purifying work of God in His church is the growth of the church. Why is this true? This is true in part because the next thing we see is this. A pure church is a powerful church. Do you see that? A pure church is a powerful church. Look at 2 Timothy 2:21. 2 Timothy 2:21. Paul, many years when he's an old man, he's writing to young Timothy and he says, "If you will keep yourself pure, you will be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean, and you will be ready for the Master to use you for every good work." Here's the wonderful part about being in the family of God. Do you know that God's not waiting for you to be a pastor to use you? Some of you think, "Oh, I've got to wait till I'm a teacher for God to use me." That's not true. What God is looking for, He's looking for a person who's pure. And remember what? That's not perfect. But one who says, "God, I'm walking in the fear of the Lord, and my life is yours, and it's for you." And God wants to use you. But you and I blow the opportunities for use by God so often because our lives just aren't ready. They're full of mess. They're full of broken things and unforgiveness and bitterness and just worldliness and all sorts of things like that. And I'm not trying to make you feel bad this morning, but I do... long for us. I long for each one of us as children of God. God wants to use you. He doesn't want to just use Pastor Renee and me. He wants to use you. But if I may use just a worldly example, but as God looks to use us, He will walk by us and tap somebody else on the shoulder if we are not in the place that God can use us. He doesn't want to use something that's dirty and messed, that not perfect, but something that's dirty and living with all of this stuff. He is looking for those, for you and for me, as our hearts are pure before Him. Oh, God, are we perfect? We're not perfect. Do we have all the tools and everything that we need? No, we don't. Do you know that those are not qualifications for use by the Lord? Here's the qualification, brothers and sisters. something that's pure, and God wants to use you, and He wants to use me. We disqualify ourselves, and what a shame, isn't it? God wants to use us. And so we see that a pure church is a powerful church. Acts 5:12-17, as God purifies His church and people are walking in the fear of the Lord. Here's this picture we see. The apostles were performing miraculous signs and wonders among the people. As a result of the apostles' work, sick people were brought out into the streets on beds and mats so that Peter's shadow might fall across some of them as he went by. Crowds came from the villages around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those possessed by evil spirits, and they were all healed. Here's this beautiful picture that we see. They were all healed. A pure church will be a powerful church because of God's manifest presence. What does manifest presence mean? It means a displayed presence of the Lord, both in churches and in our lives. And in our lives individually. And so we see this beautiful picture here of a pure church that is a powerful church walking in the fear of the Lord. Don't we want that for Lighthouse? We pray, oh God, reveal yourself. Do we ever pray that? Oh God. And sometimes we've missed that earlier step of walking in the fear of the Lord and the purity that our lives, that there must be in our lives for the Lord to walk and work in power in our church and in our lives. As we see these steps. But here we see that it's working in the right way. Here's this really interesting section here. I don't even really understand that completely. I think I have some ideas, and maybe you understand it better than I do. Some of the liberal commentators say, oh, that's just superstition. Nothing happened. You know what I think? Luke was an inspired writer. If it was just some superstitious thing, personally, I don't think Luke would have put it in the Word of God. I really don't. I think it is most likely that, in fact, as the shadow of Peter fell across some of them, it is most likely that there were healings taking place. This wonderful, this incredible thing. Now, may I ask you something, and let's just think about this for just a minute. What is going on here? Is Peter so great? Is his shadow so powerful that healing comes? What's going on here? When I see this, what it seems like to me is God heals in response to faith. He may do other things, but it's a point of contact. It's a point of faith, isn't it, as the shadow passes over? Now, I've got an example here this morning, and I have here some oil that we use at Lighthouse for anointing. And in James chapter 5, it says, if anyone is sick, let him call on the elders of the church and the prayer of faith. Anoint them with oil, the prayer of faith. It will save them. It will bring healing. But it also talks about repentance and getting our hearts right, and we miss that one sometimes. So sometimes we take some oil and we anoint someone and we pray. Is there something miraculous in this oil this morning? But are you sure? Because, by the way, this oil came from Jerusalem. Whole special, hold that beat, am I? Hold that beat. Is it special in some way because it came from Jerusalem? And I'm not trying to be flippant, but I want us to understand. No. Now, it's like, oh, it came from Jerusalem, and it has a nice smell, and maybe it was made according to some of the things that we read about in the Old Testament. But what this is a point of faith. It is a reminder of the one who heals. It's the Holy Spirit in the name and the power of Jesus, and the Holy Spirit is seen as oil, right? The oil of the Holy Spirit. So it's a point of faith, but in and of itself, there is no power in this. The power comes from the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who in His body bore our sicknesses, our brokenness on Himself, that you and I might be healed. And that has to do with the curse of sin, and it has to do with the physical healing as well. And so this is what we see as we look at this really unusual thing happening. Let me ask you a question. Now, Luke was very educated, and he says they were brought out into the streets on beds and mats. Why does he say beds and mats? Are there two different things going on? There's a bed and there's a mat. What does this mean? This is what it means. If you were rich, you slept on a bed. If you were poor, you slept on a mat. It's as simple, it is literally as simple as that. Those who did not have a lot of income, their sleeping place was a mat that was on the floor. And it's not that they were sleeping out in the streets, it was they were very sick, they were bedridden, they might have been paralyzed, and they were either on a bed or on a mat, and they were brought out into the street. So that's literally what it means. And so we see a response to the work of God from all parts of this culture, all parts of society, right? Both the rich and both the poor. May I say something to you this morning? Everybody needs a touch from Jesus. Amen. Doesn't matter if we're poor or if we're rich or if we're somewhere in between. When you see people around you, don't just look at people just like you. I'll reach them. I'll tell them about Jesus. Let your eyes be the eyes of Jesus, and that you see from the richest to the poorest and everybody in between, they all need the touch of Jesus in their lives to bring healing and wholeness. Amen. Amen. And so we see this. And so we have this beautiful picture of the church. And so now I have a question as we come to this last part this morning, and then we'll finish up. What could go wrong? It's a great church. It's living in purity. It's walking in the fear of the Lord. It's growing like nobody's business. There's unity. There's love. There's healing. There's the regard of all the people. What could go wrong? How many of you've been sailing along with the blessing of the Lord in your lives, and you think, Lord, this is great. You're walking in the sunshine of His love and the blessing of His regard, and then, boom, something happens. And you think, God, where did that come from? God, what's going on? Well, let's look at the verses immediately after this, Acts 5, 17 and 18. The high priest and his officials, who were Sadducees. Oh my goodness, here we meet some old enemies, don't we? Here we meet some old opponents. They were filled with jealousy. Why are they filled with jealousy? They're looking with natural eyes, and for them it is as simple, it's as simple as this. They're more popular than we are. That's the natural way of looking at it. More people are following them instead of us. Now what we know is this. When God is really at work in people's hearts and lives, He does not draw people to people. He draws people to Himself. That's what God does. But people that are working in a worldly way, and even sometimes Christian people, and sometimes people in the church, there will be a pulling of people to themselves, right? And we see that. We see that. It's I think, in every society, and we see that fairly commonly. God will bring people to Himself. Although there may be an initial appeal, God brings people to Himself. When we are operating in the flesh, we bring people to ourselves, right? I want people to like me. I want people to think I'm a great Bible teacher. I'm a really good Christian. And that's pretty common, brothers and sisters. And the Lord doesn't love that. He wants, because Jesus is in us, and Jesus is beautiful and lovely and appealing, that people will be drawn to Him in us. And so they're jealous, they arrest them, and they put them in the public jail. Now, in your notes, you can see that I said, you can start looking again. These are some old enemies, and they're put in the public jail. And I want you to think about what God's going to do next. Now, we already know. Look at Acts 5, 19 through 20. There are bars and prisons and jails are no obstacle for the Lord, right? You and I have some big obstacles in our lives, but for God, these are no obstacles at all. Sometimes, have you ever gotten stuck in something? I think about this, and it's a jail just as surely as bars of iron. Sometimes we get stuck in sadness or in bitterness sometimes even, and we want to be free from it, and we just feel like we can't get free, don't we? Or we even get stuck in unbelief. And we want to believe, but it feels like my heart is bound. I can't believe. I want to, but I just can't. Or old patterns or vices or things like that. And it's a prison to us. It's not a prison to God. And God could send an earthquake and open the prison, as He does later. God could cause the doors of the prison to open all by themselves, as He does later. Or he could send an angel, which he does later and he does now as well. And God sends his angel. Notice that the apostles do not say, "Angel, come, deliver us." God is the one who does it. The angel is just the messenger, right? And let me tell you who commands angels. It is bad theology to feel like you and I can command angels. I remember one time in China, you know, we all rode bicycles back then. Way back then. No cars, la. Bicycles everywhere. And I remember talking with someone who was there, and the person had put the bicycle outside the guest house where we all slept. She said, "I'm not worried about my bicycle getting stolen." And by the way, bicycles were stolen all the time in China. I mean, all the time. Mine was stolen, a really nice one. But I guess I just didn't do it right. And this person says, "I'm not worried about my bicycle getting stolen, because when I go inside, I put one angel on the front and I put one angel on the back. And then I go inside. Brothers and sisters, now, I hope you haven't done that before, but if you have done it, I just go ahead and tell you right now, that's bad theology. We don't tell angels what to do. Did you know that? God tells angels what to do. They're his messengers. They're his messengers. He's in charge of them. So you just make your prayer to God and say, "Oh God," and let God figure out how he's going to help you and deliver you. Now, we've laughed about that, but I really mean that, brothers and sisters. God is the one who determines how we will be helped and how we will be delivered. Does that make sense? That's really true. You just cry out to God. May I tell you, there are times when my prayer for help to God has been so eloquent. You know, I have such eloquence because I have years of study in English literature. And my prayer sometimes is, "Help!" That's it. "Oh God, help!" And then I let God worry about how he's going to help me. But he will help me. And so God sends the angel. He opens the gates of the jail. He does it. And he brings them out. Now, they've gotten a home. Yep. 2 minutes and we got to finish. Let's finish with this. They get a great deliverance from God. Have you ever gotten a great deliverance from God? I have. A great blessing from God. And I don't know about you, but if I were planning this great escape, do you know what I would do? I would get them delivered, and then I would say, "Now, go hide somewhere or go to another city so that they don't find you and capture you again. Run, quick, you've gotten out of prison." Now that's what we like and that's what we want, right? Yay, I've been delivered. May I tell you that God had a different plan in mind? And then we see the next part of this verse. The angel, after delivering them, tells them, click, "Go to the temple." What? The temple is where, area, that's where they have been arrested. He says, "And give the people this message of life." So at daybreak, first thing, no delayed obedience, they enter the temple as they were told and immediately began teaching. For me, here's the lesson, and you take it or not as you feel the Holy Spirit speak to you. I believe that there are times in our lives when God does wonderful things. He brings deliverance. First of all, this morning, if you are a child of God, if you are born again, may I say something to you right now? If that's the only thing that God ever does in your life, it's wonderful and it's great, because he has delivered you and me from the power of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, or the Son that he loves. And that's the greatest miracle that will ever happen in anybody's life. You and I have been set free. And sometimes we feel like when we're blessed of God and delivered, it's all, "Oh, bless me. Oh, Lord, I'm so glad. It's me, 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 me." God has something greater for our lives when he delivers us, when he saves us, when he blesses us, when he heals us. God wants others to have the message of life. The message of life. That's why I'm always so encouraged by Andrew Chan, who was in the prison of heroin for so many years, but God delivered him. He couldn't get out by himself. God delivered him. And his life now is this. He gives people the message of life wherever he goes. People know about it. He doesn't hide it. He doesn't whatever. The message of life. And you may say this morning, well, I wasn't delivered from heroin. Well, you've been delivered, and I've been delivered from the power of the devil and from other things as well. And you and I, we have a message of life that other people need to hear. Oh, brothers and sisters, may we, as we're delivered, go to the temple first thing and preach the message of life, just as we've been told. God wants to use us. Amen?
Amen?
He wants to use us. He has a plan for our lives. And that plan, as we walk in purity with him in the reverent fear of the Lord, God will do in our lives and through our lives what he has planned to do. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's close in prayer. Lord, we thank you for our brothers in the faith, all of these apostles who walked in obedience to you, who didn't run away to another town, but went straight back to the temple in obedience and began to give the message of life. Lord, in our hearts and in our lives, you have given us a message of life because you've delivered us from the power of darkness. God, as your people, may we walk in purity and in fear of you. Lord, may we have a reverent fear of you. And may that be seen in how we treat and think of and speak of our brothers and our sisters and this church that you have, of which you have made us part. Lord, may we walk with you in purity and be like you, and that we may also walk with you in power, and that power may flow through us just as it has flowed in us and bring the message of life to those around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 God bless you. Have a great